Hello and welcome to Heaven's Rain. I'm Reverend Kevin Snow, and it's exciting for you to be with us today, and we're looking forward to what the Holy Spirit's going to say as we continue our Searching for the Glory series, and we're going to dive deep into this subject today, and we're going to just allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us and to reveal His nature to us. And so we're going to begin today. We're going to cover two different points that I believe are very important in searching for the glory of God. Again, this is a subject that goes deep into my heart because of the places where God has led me and where God has taught me how, when in the middle of crises or in the middle of success, in the middle of anything, how that the glory of God is always there. And so it's vitally important that we understand the glory of God, where He's coming from, and what it is God is trying to accomplish and the lessons that we need to learn. And so the first thing we're going to cover today is about surrender. Now, this is a topic that's dear to my heart because this is the key ingredient. This is where it all began, is where I had to actually stop and focus on the surrender I needed to do before the presence of the Lord. So within the realm of surrender is where we're going to find where God is doing a lot of the inner work within our hearts and within our spirits. And this is where we're having probably the strongholds that we're dealing with. And this is where God is asking for permission to enter the places of our hearts where He's not formally been given permission to go. Believe it or not, there's a lot of places in Christians' lives where we've not allowed the Holy Spirit to truly investigate, to truly reveal within us, and to truly redeem. God is wanting to redeem all these areas individually in our hearts as He's dealing with them, and He can only do that as we surrender them to Him. And so, yes, when we come to God as newborn Christians, we come to God, we give Him everything, but eventually He's going to start asking for things and He's going to start presenting Himself because He's going to start requiring things of us. And there are things, pieces of our lives that He wants us to surrender. I remember when I was an early Christian, he asked for my future. He asked for everything. And when he called me into ministry, it interrupted my plans. I didn't have that many plans because I wasn't really given that opportunity. But still, I knew that the Holy Spirit was calling me into ministry. And it was a very scary thing for me to do because I was a very shy young man and I was very introverted. And so for the Lord to call me to pulpit ministry was a huge ordeal. And I had a lot of hurdles I had to jump. And I was, of course, extremely nervous. But I tell you, God had to require that of me so that I could actually give it. But as I began to grow in the Lord, He began to require different things. And it seemed like those things began to get smaller and smaller. And now He's really dealing with intimate areas of my life. And as I surrender those things, I begin and I find that it's easier to surrender more things to the Lord. Because the more I surrender to Him, the more I trust Him. Because I see the work of what He's doing in my life. I see the evidence of it that happens all the time. And so therefore it encourages me to surrender more. And so in James 4:7, it says, "Therefore submit to God," one of my favorite passages of Scripture, "but resist the devil and he will flee from you." Now, most people stop right there because they don't understand what has to go on to the, as we enter verse number 8. "Draw near to God, He will draw near to you." So when He says submit, therefore submit to God, that is a surrender. That is, I'm coming under the authority of the Word of God. I'm coming under the presence of the living God. I am surrendering myself to you, and I'm inviting you, and I'm submitting. I'm no longer in charge of my life. I'm no longer dictating control. I'm no longer the one who is saying that I can do this and I can do that. That's not me. I'm actually the one who's surrendering to God, and He's directing my paths, and He's guiding my footsteps, and He's given me instructions. Now, there are, of course, times I'm still an individual, I'm still human, I still make mistakes. And so in doing so, I have to understand that God is allowing me to do some things, and God is allowing me to grow and allowing me to learn. God is very, very patient. He's much more patient with me than I'm patient with myself. And so as God is teaching us, and as we're submitting to God, we're learning things about ourselves, we're learning things about God. Now, God will take you down this road as fast as you want to go. And I don't want to give away what happens when we do this, because I want you just to focus on the benefits of surrender, of that true surrender. This is a sermon series, of course, all by itself. So we're just going to cover half of it, just a little bit of today, some of the tidbits and the important parts of what surrender does. But as we see here, as we submit ourselves to God, we can resist the devil. He will flee from us. So one of the best benefits of surrender is this right here. It is not giving the devil authority in our lives to influence us. So whenever we find ourselves depressed, angry, tempted, or we're succumbing to temptation, there's so many different things, we can find probably an area in our lives where that has not been surrendered to God. And it's probably an area that God is wanting us to surrender to Him. Again, I tell people many times that you only have to surrender to God what the Holy Spirit is revealing to you at the moment. God isn't asking you for a whole bucket list of stuff and overwhelm you with things. All you have to do is ask God for one thing today. And as you begin to ask God for that one thing, trust the Holy Spirit to show you. One of the ways that the Holy Spirit taught me, because as a man, I'm not really that good with my emotions and getting in tune with it. So the Lord told me, He said, I want you to ask yourself a question. So if you find yourself being tempted, which is what I was doing, tempted to do sin, again, it's not about whether you pass or fail, it's did you learn the lesson? And so He said, what was you feeling? What was you going through when temptation came? And I began to go back and think, okay, well, my wife and I had an argument and it was painful. She said some things, I said some things. And so therefore, I don't know, I'm internalizing this. And so, and God says, say, how do you feel about that? What's going on? Well, it made me angry when she said this, and it made me feel bad when she said that. And I said, I want you to give me those emotional needs that you have right there. And I began to think, okay, well, how do I do that? And He said, just surrender them to me. So I just had to imagine myself holding those emotional needs within me, because we all have disagreements with our spouses, and so it's a common thing. So I just began to give that to the Lord, and I began to just hold it there in front of Him. He said, now I want you to watch my blood cover it. As you surrender it, the blood of Jesus is going to cover it. So I want you just to ask. And I began to ask for the blood of Jesus to cover it. And I began to do that. And I began to see that in my spirit. The blood of Jesus covers it all. I'm surrendering it to God. Now again, we have to stay in His presence and we have to receive something from God, because I don't want to leave this space open, because the enemy is using these emotions to gain access into my life. And so once I surrender those things to the Lord, I stay at His feet and I rejoice and I begin to receive from God what He has. And in many cases, especially when it comes to a spouse, I just begin to receive peace. I begin to receive love, love that I could give her in return, because she's going through her own issues that I have to be the husband, the man of God in the family and in the home to be able to give that stuff back to her. Otherwise, I don't want to stay angry. I don't want to stay mad. I don't want to stay withdrawn and introverted. I want to be able to give of myself and give of her the love that she needs to be able to live. And so this was one of the keys that actually saved my marriage at the time, because God is a powerful God and He knows what He's doing. And so as we submit ourselves to God, the devil has to get his hands off of our lives. He has to resist. He has to flee. How many of you want to get the devil out of your life? Well, this is how you do it. You can't shortcut around this. You can't just beat around the bush and just think, oh, I don't have to really surrender to God. I can do it this other way. No, you have to surrender. If you really want God and you want to invade your life and get the devil out of your life, this is the simple task to do it. So as I began to just ask God, show me that one thing, He would show me that thing. And again, He tied it to my emotions and what I was experiencing and what I was going through. Whether I was bored, whether again I was angry, whether I was being tempted, no matter, find out what the emotion that you're experiencing, because I can assure you of this, it's something that you're not trusting God with. Everywhere there is an open door, and everywhere where you're being tripped up and where you're failing is because it's an area that has not been surrendered to the Lord. Perhaps it's greed. It could be money related. It could be lust related. It could be just within your own self-esteem. It could be so many different things. And so the Lord is asking us to be able to surrender those things to Him. He goes on to say in James chapter 4, verse 8, cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. So he's telling them to do that. So guess what? He's saying, you go cleanse your own hands. You go purify your own heart. How do you purify your own heart? That's a pretty hard job to do. This is how you do it. You surrender it before the Lord, and you plead the blood of Jesus over it, and you just ask God to take those things away. And you just don't stop. You continue to do this. This becomes a part of your daily walk with God, your daily lifestyle. And so as you begin this on a daily walk, he's going to start dealing with things in the past. And he's going to go back far. The good news is you don't have to go back all the way to you were born. But the Lord is going to go back because he's going to deal with root issues that happened to you as a child. Because it's much easier for the Lord to dig up the root system of something that's been there for 20 years or more and dig that up, and everything else that's joined to that root system comes out with it. That's called a deliverance, may I add. And so as the Lord digs all that up out of your heart and out of your life, God will replace that with good soil and with the fruit of the Word of God that he wants it to bear, and get rid of all the thorns and get rid of all the stones and get rid of all the things that have been troubling you in your walk with God. Let's move on. In Galatians 2:20, it says, I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. This is talking about the deepest surrender that you and I can get to. This is the goal. This is what our attitude needs to be. Our mindset needs to be. This is the way our heart needs to be. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. So my life is no longer my own. Your life is no longer your own. When you surrender to the Lord and you gave him your heart and your life, you said, I'm no longer going to be in control of my life. I'm going to let you do that for me, Lord. So that means God's going to put you on the career path that he wants you to be on. He wants you to go to the school that he wants you to go to, because he knows already what our future is. He already knows what it holds. He's all-knowing. He's already in our future. So if we start making our own decisions and we start going our own way, guess what? We derail ourselves off of the plan of God, and now he has to make alterations to that and to get us back on track. And so now he has to go back and figure this out, because now we've derailed it. And so once we derail it, there's a whole process of getting that back, because it doesn't just happen overnight. We just can't go back and just redo things as much as we wish we could. There's no time machine to go back and redo it. God does give us a start over pass, but guess what? We're going to have to surrender more things, because we have to find out why we rebelled in the first place, why we said no, why we ran from the calling of God, why we stopped, and why we didn't allow God to move in that way in our lives. So surrender is so vitally important. The second thing I want to talk to you about is about rest. Now, this is an interesting one, because this is probably the hardest for especially people who like to work. This is the hardest thing for us to do, is to rest. I find myself working all the time because I enjoy working. I especially enjoy working for God. I enjoy working with my hands sometimes, depending on what it is. I enjoy doing different things, and so it's hard for me sometimes to sit down and take a break. And so the Sabbath becomes a bit of a challenge for me at times, because I do enjoy working. And so, but eventually, of course, that catches up with me, where my body is forced just to veg and relax on the couch and just take a moment and take a break. And so there's a lot of stress that goes on with life. There's a lot of anxiety. There's a lot of things that are coming against us every day. And so rest is such a vitally important component of searching for the glory of God, because you can't do anything when you're stressed out. You can't do anything when you're tired. You can't do it when your brain is fogged and when you can't even concentrate on anything. So let's read Matthew 11, 28 through 30. It says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, I will give you rest. So there is the guarantee. There is the part that Jesus puts it in there. So when you're seeing these scriptures and you're reading these scriptures, especially when Jesus is talking, if you do this, I will do this. Those are promises that he makes in scripture, and those are promises that he keeps. And so we got to remember that. And so when my experience doesn't match his word, guess what happens? I have to surrender my experience to the Word of God and say, the Word of God trumps my experience. So it overrides it. It doesn't matter what my experience is or what my knowledge is or what it is I think is right or whatever is going on. The Word of God overrides my opinion and my authority over my own life. Jesus said, come to me if you're all that are weary and are heavy laden. All, everyone. So everyone is included in that fold, and I believe everybody is weary and heavy laden. He says, I will give you rest. So this is in the middle of your battle. This is in the middle of your mess. This is in the middle of your confusion. This is in the middle of your success. This is in the middle of everything. Because even in success, you can become tired and you can become weary. I remember when we were working in Mexico and our ministry was just going, it seemed like 100 miles an hour. And I had to really learn how to take a pause in that because there were so many demands being put upon us to travel here and travel there, minister there. And I'm like, well, first of all, we've got to have the resources to pay for all this travel. And I don't want to be away from my family, you know, for 30 days. And so I spent maybe 2 weeks away from my family. And I'm like, this is too much. And it ended up being too taxing on my body physically. I got sick while I was there. Here I was praying for the sick and they were being healed. And then I was sick. And it was an interesting thing, but God redeemed that situation. And I just literally exhausted myself from success. So it doesn't matter whether you're failing or succeeding. God is saying, I want you to take rest. No matter what it is that you're doing, because your body can only handle so much. He goes on to say, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Learn. So here we go. Jesus is saying, I want you to watch me. Now, you go through his ministry, you go through the pages of scripture, and you find out when he withdraws himself from the crowds, when he pulls himself away, even from the disciples, to get away and pray. Many times he goes to the mountain, he goes to a secluded place, he gets away from the towns, from the cities, where he's in demand, and where everybody's trying to attack him, and they're wanting him to teach, and they're wanting him to pray for them and heal them and so forth. And he's saying, learn from me, learn from my example. Jesus always did this. He pulled himself away. He spent time with the Father. He got information that he needed about his future. He laid down all of his burdens himself when he was tired because he was in a physical body. So he also got tired. And he rested as well. He says, come to me, learn from me, for I am gentle and I am humble in heart. So Jesus isn't angry at you. He's not angry at me. He's not disappointed in us. He just wants us to come to him. How beautiful and how simple is that? So he wants us to surrender. He wants us to have rest in him. He wants to help us with those things because he understands our physical bodies are limited. So no matter how anointed you and I can get or be, our physical bodies are still limited and still can only handle so much. So especially the way that we eat and the way that we treat our bodies, you have to be very careful and be able to understand what it is the Lord is asking you to do. He says, I'm gentle, I'm humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. So this is a deep rest. There's nothing better than a good night's sleep where you've had a solid, you know, 6, 7, 8 hours of sleep and you wake up refreshed. Most of the time, I sleep 3 or 4 hours and then I'm awake again. And I don't understand why that is, but when I wake up, I'm just like, Lord, I'm just going to focus on you because my mind starts racing. It starts going over the things that we're experiencing, problems, stress, and it starts wandering off and it just starts doing weird things. And I just begin to say, Lord, I'm just going to focus on you right now. And I'm going to focus on what you have. And I'm just going to, if you want me to pray for somebody, tell me who they are. I'll pray for them. I don't care what time of the morning it is. I'm awake anyway. It's not like I'm going to fall asleep really quickly now. And so you have my attention. And so I just begin to do that. Sometimes the Lord speaks a word to me that brings peace to my soul. Sometimes he tells me to pray for somebody in the middle of the night. And I just go with it. I just follow the voice of the Lord. But anyway, he says, you'll find rest for your souls. That is a rest that is so deep that even if you maybe sleep through 3 or 4 hours, you're still awake, but you feel like you've slept 8 hours. Have you ever had that before? I've had it many times. where you're not tired when you get up and you're just like, I feel so good right now. I don't understand that. And so, but the Lord is saying, I'm giving you rest for your soul. So when your soul is resting, that's when everything, that's when you know you're truly at peace within your heart and within your life, because your soul is no longer troubled over all the issues that you're facing in your life. When you can truly sleep and you can truly receive a divine rest from God. He says, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So I want to encourage you, if you're in ministry or if you're experiencing a hardship or a heaviness because of the ministry that you're in, then I want to probably tell you, because I have been there before myself, that you're carrying too much of the burden. You're not working hand in hand with God. I can remember one of the first times that I had ever done this, and I'd been in ministry about 2 decades before this actually happened. I remember when we were working in that ministry in Mexico, and I felt the Lord say, take my hand and I'm going to go with you and I'm going to help you. We're going to co-labor together, just like the scripture says. And because before that, I was always striving, I was always trying, I was always building, and things were just falling apart. I was always, you know, having a hard time, a hard go of it. I was discouraged, I was distraught. But now when I felt my hand and God's hand, our hands joined together, everything just changed. Everything was easier. And I mean, I was going on, like I said, I felt 100 miles an hour, but I didn't get tired and I didn't get burned out. And I was just constantly being fueled, and it was like a fascinating thing, because all of a sudden I was realizing, and I was the fulfillment of the scripture, it's true. His yoke is easy. His burden is light. Even though there were bad things happening all around me, it didn't matter. I didn't care. I knew that God had me, because I knew my hand was in His hand. His hand was in my hand, and it was an amazing feeling when I began to experience that. So I've done both sides. I've done it my way and I've done it God's way. And I can assure you, doing it God's way is a whole lot better than doing it your own way. So I also want to read Exodus 33:14. It says, and He said, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. This is in the context of this chapter. This is one of my favorite verses, because it says, my presence will go with you. This is the children of Israel about to go into the promised land, and God is talking to Moses about it. And He says, my presence will go with you. And this is one of the things that I learned throughout my walk, is never go where the Holy Spirit is not going to go there before you. And so, yes, we know that God is everywhere, but God doesn't want you everywhere all the time. So God is omnipresent. I am not omnipresent. Yes, this video is going on the internet and it can be watched at any time, at anywhere, when anybody finds it. But at the same time, I said, that doesn't make me omnipresent. God is truly omnipresent. He's truly all over the world at the same time. He's just not one place and not another. He's the only one who can do that. The devil is not omnipresent. He can only be at one place at a time. He is a spirit being that has been created. So no matter what he tells you, no matter what he says, that's not true. He is not an omnipresent being. But He said, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. So when God says my presence will go with you, that means I'm going to go not only before you, but I'm going to walk with you, and I'm going to make sure you're getting the rest along the way that you need. Again, God knows that our human bodies are just clay. We're just dust. We're going to die one day. Everybody's going to die, and except for those who obviously go up in the rapture. We're all going to die. This body was made to be born, and it was made to die. And so our spirits go to heaven when we die, and so therefore that's what we spend eternity with. And our spirits go there, then our bodies, of course, are raised up in the rapture. The Bible says the dead in Christ are raised, and so we're excited when that happens, obviously, but we don't know when that's going to happen. So in the meantime, we keep living, we keep occupying, we keep working for God and with God, we keep loving God, we keep sharing the truth of God's Word, we kept just ministering our hearts before the Lord, and we just keep doing what the Lord is asking us to do. And so as we're covering this part about surrender and rest, I just want to say it's just so vitally important that as you're surrendering yourself to God, that you're laying it out there. There's no need of hiding anything from God, because He already knows anyway. And so there's no need to just to mess around with it. Let the Holy Spirit show you. Just ask Him, Holy Spirit, show me. show me what I need to surrender today, and show me the ways I need to submit myself to you to get rest, how to work with God, how to work hand in hand with God, how to be able just to understand everything that God is trying to accomplish in my life. So I want to pray for you these last few moments of this video. And I want you just to prepare your heart, because if you're burdened and you are heavy laden and you're stressed out and you're burned out, I have been there on all those fronts, and maybe you haven't surrendered and your life is just a disaster, because that's the road the unsurrendered life goes down. Everything falls apart. Again, I have been there. My wife and I are coming out of a very long wilderness season. And a lot of it was our own choosing, our own doing, but it was also God ordained, because He's entering us into a new season of blessing and of prosperity that we're so greatly looking forward to. And so it's important to know that surrender is what makes that transition a whole lot easier. So Father God, I pray for all those who are watching this video right now. I pray for them, Lord God, that your spirit is already with them. You've already drawn close to them. You're already right there in front of them. You're actually face to face with them right now, as you're face to face with me. And Holy Spirit, I'm asking you, God, that you would just begin to reveal yourself to these wonderful people. God, these people they don't know what to do. And they're trying to grasp what we're saying here today. So I'm asking you, Holy Spirit, to show them, teach them, as I've been teaching them, how to surrender to you. Just show them that one thing that you're asking for, Lord. Reveal to them, God, what you're wanting to do in their life. And as you reveal them, God, I pray, God, that they would just trust you. One of the key elements of surrender is trust. And that is giving God what He's requiring. And sometimes it's very difficult to do that, because we don't understand how much we value even the weird things in our life, the things that aren't even right. Sometimes we put too much value on them. So God, I pray that you would just begin to help them to surrender those things right now, as we choose to trust you. We choose to trust your word. We choose to trust your power. We choose to trust what you're doing. We choose to trust you, Lord God, in our surrender. And we also choose to trust you in our labors for you, Lord God. We confess that we've done it our own way. We've confessed, Lord God, that we've chosen things that we should not have chosen. We confess that we've tried to do it without you, including ministry, jobs, it doesn't matter, finances, marriage, raising kids. God, we tried to do it without you. And you said, come to me, all you that are burdened, you're heavy laden, I'll give you rest. So the reason why we're not experiencing rest, and we're not experiencing abundance, and we're not experiencing clean hands is because, well, God, we're trying to do all this ourselves. We're trying to do it on our own abilities, our own knowledge, our own power, our own money, everything. And so, God, we understand we cannot do this without you. We cannot do this without you. So, God, we put our hands out. We ask you that you put your hand in our hands. God, we're not going to do this our way anymore. God, we commit our ways to you. We're going to do this your way, because you are the Lord, you are King, you are God. And God, we desperately need you today to move on our behalf. And God, we surrender ourselves. We choose you, Lord God. We choose rest. We choose holiness. We choose righteousness. We choose you, Lord. We've done it our own way. We confess it as sin and wrong. And God, we choose to walk in your kingdom and in your glory. And we say thank you, Lord, because you're revealing the glory to us as we're searching it out. We're seeking the kingdom of God. We're searching for the glory of God in the middle of our mess, in the middle of it all, because you are here with us in the middle of it all. You're in the middle of the sickness. You're in the middle of the mess. You're in the middle of the bankruptcy. You're in the middle of all of it. And we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name, because your Holy Spirit is guiding us into all truth. And we thank you in Jesus' name. We give you glory and praise and honor. Now I want you to spend some time worshiping the Lord and thanking Him for answering these prayers and being with you today. God so richly bless you. We want to see you again for the next installment of Searching for the Glory series. God bless you today.